part of that song. How many of you ever heard of that song? See, for my classics, now you just know that's Imagine Dragons. So now you know an Imagine Dragons song. But I need you to stand up, everybody. I haven't had you stand up yet today, so stand up right where you are, because I'm going to read the phrase from the song. Sam, turn the slide. Here it is. And I know it's hard when you're falling down, and it's a long way up. The older we get, the getting up is a lot longer, I'm telling you. But a long way up when you hit the ground. But it tells us we've got to get up now. Get up now. Get up now. You'll go ahead and take a seat this morning. The sermon title this morning is, We Gotta Get Up Now. You sit there and I talk about the victory, and that's the reason why it was perfect that the song Pastor Kimberly picked out, and victory in Jesus. It is here. It is now. I don't know of any other time in my pastoral life that I've really been more understanding that it is about the now. I started a plan of this church with Pastor Kimberly, and we always looked at, and I was asked, what's the 5-year plan, the 10-year plan, where do you see yourself, and all these things. And I used to have those images in my head, but I literally now live for the now. There is way too much about next week that I have to, can't even fathom or think about, that I need to get up now. And I know, you know the scripture that in and out of season, you have to be prepared. You must be ready. And I know that some of you feel like, yeah, I've had that moment where I was all about Jesus, or you've walked the aisle and you've got your sword and you're ready to go out and cut everybody down who doesn't know Jesus. And I know many of you have been on the mountaintop and you've screamed his name and all those things. But listen, it's not a past tense thing. It's about the now. And we've got to get up now, because the victory is ours through Jesus Christ. We've got to be about the now. Like I said, I don't feel really well, and you're sitting there, you know, as you're preparing the sermon. I got it done yesterday morning. I got up early, did the sermon, went and saw our track team off at Chick-fil-A, and then I followed them up there and was in Gainesville last night until, I don't know, late, and then driving home last night, getting in late. And listen, every part of me could have said, I'm not coming. People even ask, you got somebody else? My mama asked me, ooh, you got somebody else preaching tomorrow? No, I am going to be there, because it's about the now. And listen, no matter how bad I feel, my victory is in Jesus. Here's some reminders I want to, it's not going to be a long sermon, but it's a powerful understanding that we're on top of the world. But thanks be to God, He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Everybody say the word victory.
Victory.
It's a good feeling. Victory, winning is great. Like I said, I was at the state track meet yesterday, and you watch people go around there, and it is kind of heartbreaking for those that don't win. You watch athletes fall down. You see them, they come in, and they're going to do this, and the 4x100, the team was ranked 13th coming in to the thing. There's only 16 teams. But the team that was ranked 13th actually set a state record. They blew it away. They were just, and you sit there and you see victory. But I'm going to tell you, what touched my heart was when there was one athlete, an ambulatory athlete with special needs and handicap, who ran a 200 meters by themselves, and the entire stand was standing and just cheering that one athlete on. That was pure victory. To watch the three, and there was one race, there was three, and the one poor third kid, he was ambulatory as well, and he was well in the back. I'm telling you, it was 200 meters, and he was 100 meters behind the winners. But as he was running that last 100 meters, and the announcer was going, he is going to set his personal best by 30 seconds, and the crowd is chanting. He was number one when he crossed that line and looked around. That's the victory that we have. The victory that we have, I realized yesterday, and as I'd already prepared the sermon, is in the fact that Miss Rogers is here. The victory that we have is, no matter how bad we feel, we walk in and somebody says, it's good to see you. The victory we have is not in all the great times that we go through. It's in the struggles when we make it through it. That's the victory that we have. And guess what? It was given to a select few. No, it was given only to that denomination. No, it was given only to the big churches. No, it was given through our Lord Jesus Christ. So this morning, if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord, you got to kind of take the sentence backwards. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord, then you have victory today.
Amen.
Amen. And that's exciting. I'm victor. I won. No matter how bad I feel, I have won. So I believe the encouragement from the music and from the sermon today is we've got to get up now. Here's what the Bible says about getting up now. Therefore, if he was sitting right there, Eddie would be go. I'd look at Eddie right now and go, it's a therefore. Anytime you see a but or therefore in the Bible, you better tune in. Because but's usually kind of a warning. Hey, you can do this, but, oh, I got to warn. Therefore means I've said something, therefore you must understand something. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, for my sisters in the house, stand firm. Stand firm. Listen, the world is trying to knock you off of your balance, off of your cornerstone. The world is trying to beat you down so that you don't stand firm. The world is changing rules and laws and what we call socially acceptable and politically correct. And they're changing them so that you can't stand firm. You can stand firm. You just might need to understand what the firmness means. I try to teach people all the time because sometimes they'll say that I'm not running through the halls of my school just screaming, Jesus Christ, but I'm living it out daily. The many times that I have people come in, will you pray with me? Will you pray for me? Absolutely. Let me tell you, you need to stand firm in who Christ is in you, not who you think you ought to be. Stop living out as you're like the, I know this will sound strange, hold on to it. You are the church. And I know that when we go from here and we depart from here, the church goes with you. And we are the church. It's not the four walls. The people are the church. But they don't want to see the church. They want to see Christ. People have been hurt by what we call the church. People will say, well, I don't want to be a part of that. I don't care if you're ever part of my church. I want you to accept Jesus Christ because there's not victory in one accord. There's victory in Jesus Christ. I'm trying to get you to accept Him. I don't invite everybody to my church. Why? Because I don't love you guys. I love you guys. But first and foremost, some people don't need to come to church. They need to come to Jesus. And we need to get them there. And I'm telling you, I promise you, I believe this. If they fully are accepting of Jesus Christ and they're sold out and they understand who He is and all that He's done in their life, they're going to want to know more about Him. They're going to want to be around Him more often. And they're going to especially want to be around people that have like-mindedness. And that's you guys. You see how that goes? We get them into church and all of a sudden we get them into Christ and then we'll get them into church. Let nothing move you, nothing of this world. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord. Woo! Not the work of your spouse, honey-do lists. Not the work of your boss, but always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord because you know that your labor in the Lord is what? Not in vain. Any of you that have worked a job for any more than a day know that there are many times that you do a task and it's absolutely in vain. Military was when Victor and I were just having that talk. There were many times they would look at you and they would say, do this. And you're like, that seems pretty stupid. That doesn't help us out. I can remember basic training. One of the best times was when it was hot in Columbus, South Carolina. It got hot, didn't it, Mom? You were out there. And they'd have to blouse your BDUs, and I hated doing that and everything. But all of a sudden, I remember one day we're out doing a field exercise, and it was miserably hot. And we were all getting dehydrated, and we were just miserable. And all of a sudden, they said, all right, drink water. And they forced you to. That's why I don't drink water anymore. Mountain Dew only. Because they used to force me to do it. Drink water! Until all of a sudden, our canteens were empty. And they made us sit there for a while without water in our canteens. And we're thinking, oh, man, if they... Finally, they say, okay... Go over to the buffalo, water buffalo, with bottled water, and fill it up. But don't drink it. And we're like, okay. They're going to do some military stuff where they make you sit there and look at it. So they did. We all lined up. We all filled up our canteens. And we all had the plastic ones, not the old. Some of you guys had the old metal ones, but we had plastic. And they would sit there and they'd say, now look at your canteen. And we'd hold it in our hands. And we looked at it and we're thinking, man, I can't wait to drink this. All I need to do is drink it. The best decision right now is to drink that water. And they'd say, lift your canteens and pour it on your head. That didn't sound very helpful right then. I am thirsting to death. And they would say, pour it on your head. We heard that heat injuries, your head's hot. You don't want to put water on it because you get. And we poured it on our head. And I'm thinking, how stupid is that? But it was following orders. And listen, I don't know where, and I hope this doesn't make anybody mad. I don't know where we got to be people that question what God tells us what to do. You will have somebody and you'll go, well, why'd you do that? Because my boss said so. Many of you sitting here, it's usually my brothers in arm, will say, well, why did you do that? Because my wife told me to do that. Okay, I understand that. I feel your pain. I know that. But why all of a sudden, out of all the authoritative figures on this earth, whether it be your spouse, whether it be your boss at work, whether it be the pastor of the church, why do we stop listening when God says something? He says, do as I tell you to do, accept and receive and believe and live in the victory. Let nothing move you. He's really saying, don't let anything move you. That's an order. Well, you know, you weren't around when there was like TikTok. And it's like, Lord's like, I understand. I am greater than all things. Well, you know, my boss will fire me. Stand firm and trust in Jesus Christ. You know how I know that I'm doing the right thing when I'm trusting Jesus Christ and I'm at work and people say, well, it could be a little slippery slope. No, it's not. God gave me the job. I believe that. I believe He placed me there. So why would I not respect and honor Him by living the life out that He's called me to be? I'm asking you, stop testing God and not believing what He says. So we need to remember that the victory is in Christ. Get up now. And here's the key to this whole sermon. Sammy, turn the slide. That's the key right there. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. You want to overcome the flesh that you live in? You want to overcome the temptations of the earth? You want to overcome the deceit and lies of man? Everyone born of God. Not born of flesh. Guess what? Every one of you was born of flesh. No test tube babies in here. I know that. I've checked your birth records. Everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world. Even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only he who believes through faith and trust that Jesus is the Son of God. If you believe anything else, just take away everything I've already said to you today. Here's the sad, disheartening part. For those that don't believe Jesus is the Son of God, who freely gave His life for us so that He could take the sins of our lives and our actions and take them and just spread them on the cross so that we could be forgiven. If you don't believe that, you can't have victory. You're a loser. I say that with great love. You have already lost the battle. I don't know, Dad, he was a commissioned officer who planned things. Some of you have coached things. Some of you have led businesses. If I told you today that I'm going to have you start a company and you knew when you started that it was going to fail, most of you would just look at me like I'm crazy and say, no. I'm not part of that. If you're going into a game, and Sammy's lived this out wonderfully for a few years, if you go in with the mindset that you're going to lose, you have already lost. If we could get people to understand that without Jesus Christ, they've already lost. The song says, I once was lost. Listen, they're lost for sure, and they've lost because they have no victory in Christ. If we could get them to realize that, the only way out would be to accept Jesus Christ and live out a life faithfully trusting in Him. He who believes that Jesus is the Son of God, he who has faith, in the book of Romans, it says it kind of like this in a different wording, but it says almost the same. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. If you're having one of your pity parties, you're ever getting one of those moments where you feel like, nobody cares for me. He loves you. Well, I don't feel worthy. He loves you. God don't make no junk. I always like that old saying. Now I get a t-shirt. God don't make no junk. He made you. I am fearfully and wonderfully made in the Lord. God loves you. And guess what you are there for? Not a loser, not a sideline player, but a conqueror. What a powerful word. Plunged in His victory. Falling down into the conquering overpowering victory of Jesus Christ. There are a lot of things that get you guys excited, I'm sure. It's sports, whatever your little thing is, your favorite TV show or something, your favorite song. You hear it, you get all screaming. I really don't understand why we're not just screaming for God. You know what I'm saying? I'm not asking, don't get up screaming. That'll scare me if y'all all died. I would think there's a new church here. I'd be like, who are those people? I don't know who they are. But listen, in your life, and you can live it out loud without ever saying a word. I am told at work that I am just loud by nature. I stand in the main hall, in the main administration, or in the main office. And if I'm in the front, they hear me forever. My office is way in the back, and people know where it is just by listening and hearing where I am. I am told, Eric can tell you, I'm pretty loud in the hallways too. I'm always saying stuff and hollering things. I'm loud by nature, and I'm okay with that. But when I live my life out, I want to live it loudly for Jesus. I don't want people to have to question whether or not I am a believer. If they have to ask you, do you go to church? Do you know God? Then you aren't living it out if they've seen your life example. The only person that's ever, or the only group that's ever confused the lost are the believers. For far too long, the church and those who follow Jesus Christ made it look so much like the world that they don't really understand why there is a difference. We need to live it out so that they can see clearly the victory. I can tell you, at the end of a game, it's pretty easy to tell who won the game. When we go and watch baseball, DDJ is up there. We know who wins. You can tell when the boys are throwing their gloves up in the air and they're shouting and screaming that they won. Rarely do you ever see a losing team just go into a celebration, because if you do, the coach is going to be really mad. Y'all are excited about losing? That's what scares me. There are people in this world that are walking in your families, in your workplaces that you know, that are excited about losing. As those who know the great and ultimate coach, Jesus, we need to be about his team and stop worrying about what they think. There is victory is resting in his reign. That's how I knew today was the right day for this sermon. That's how the day I knew, as badly as I felt, the victory that I have in Jesus is a resting place. You say, well, victory is only given to those who train extra hard and give all that extra effort. Victory is not in our ability, but in his reign. Who does God reign over? Everybody, there you go. Everyone, right? My victory is resting in the fact that he's already won the war. My victory is resting in the fact that all the struggles and battles that I face, he's already conquered on the cross. That's the victory I have. It is amazing to me, and I started reading the scriptures and I was getting prepared and I started thinking about it. He gives us the armor of God. He gives us the sword. He gives us all this shield and everything. But guess what? He fought the war. He just wants us to look real cool, man. I'd love to have a suit of armor. Byron's going, yeah, he's Viking, right? I'd be kind of medieval and you'd be Viking. We would love to have that. I think that stuff is really, really cool. But when I put on the armor of God, I am telling you, my victory has already been won. I don't have to draw my sword. He drew it for us. I get to wear it and be a proud representation of all that he's done, all that he's doing, and all that he shall do. My victory resting in his reign. Matthew says to thee, come to me with all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. How many of you today need rest? Raise your hand. Amen, amen. Those of you who didn't need, raise your hand, you do need rest. You just don't understand it yet. I've always loved it like this. I've said this, and if you don't sleep well, I know there's medical things, but I believe that people that can't sleep haven't done enough in the day. I think if you stay up long enough, you're going to sleep. Now, Kimberly does it really well because she sleeps like perfectly for the energy, and she just does it so beautifully. I wish I could do that. I can't do that. I got to sleep 8 hours straight. Y'all like, you sleep 8 hours? A lot of times. I like a good 8 hours sleep. Put my CPAP mask. I've realized that anything past 8 hours, the CPAP mask goes into a hurricane mode, and I can't breathe anymore because it's just making this loud, thunderous noise. If you have a CPAP mask, you understand what I'm talking about. It gets a little loud after 8 hours. I like a long rest. So what do? I work really hard so I'm really tired so I can get a long rest. Same thing in Christ. I'm going to work and do everything that he's asked me to do so that I can truly rest in him and fully receive that rest and restoration. Jesus Christ restores me each and every day. Romans 5 and 17, for it is by the trespass of the one man, death reigned through that one man. How much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace? That sounds beautiful. An abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man. And that one man happens to be Jesus Christ. It's not your pastor. It's not your boss. It's not your spouse. It's through Jesus Christ. On top of the world. I was going to show you the video clip, last slide, Sam. I think there's one last one. We're in a, but not of the, we're of, but how are we? In this world, but not of this world. If I want you to understand who you are in Christ, is you're on top of the world. Sometimes it gets a little cold on top of the world. That's okay. Sometimes it gets a little, could be a rainstorm up there on the top of the world. That's okay, but you're on top of the world. Why? Because Christ conquered this world. By the price he paid on the cross, we have victory in Jesus. So my only question is today, and I won't say it that way. I was going to say it one way, and it sounds really wrong. You want to be a loser the rest of your life? Sounds like a bad movie, right? If you want to know, then you're a winner. As the song says, that one day those mansions of glory that he's already prepared for us. If you really want to understand that this world is not going to defeat you, then it is only in Christ. Let me take some pressure off you. It's not in church attendance. Although we love having you together. Love seeing you when the body's together. There's always a good smile on our face. We love to fellowship. It's not in your giving. It's not in your head knowledge. It's not in the things that you've done, but it's in Jesus Christ. Now the neat part about that is once you gain that victory in him and through the price he paid, you're going to totally want to live your life. That's why I always talk about when people say once saved, always saved. I say, you got to be really saved. It's not once down the aisle. Doesn't say that. It doesn't say once in the water. Doesn't say that. It said once truly saved. When you come to a clear understanding of who Christ is, you want to follow him. You want to listen to him. You don't want to let him down. You don't want to do things that go against him. You want to trust truly in his victory and live a life out. Following, believing, and obeying. On top of the world. Many of you are saying from the old James Cagney movie, right? Look, Mom, on the top of the world. That's actually not a really good scene. I'm going to show it in church today. He blows everything up after that. So we're not going to blow anything up, but we're going to celebrate that in Christ. We have absolute victory over this world. Let's pray together this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you once again. Thank you for your word. Not the words, but your word. The spoken message that you have for us today. As we look around, Lord, we see struggles everywhere. We see war, we see destruction, we see sadness all over this planet. At times it feels like, Lord, and I say the word feels like, we're losing ground. In a worldview, it may look like we're getting defeated at every turn. But I am thankful, Lord. As clear as it can be said, in faith, believing, and receiving Jesus Christ, we have victory. I celebrate and thank you for my victory daily. Lord, my prayer for me is that I can continue to live it out loud as I stand on top of the world. I can shout to the mountains how amazing your love and your grace and your mercy is pouring and flowing over me every day. I pray for this body of believers. I pray that we will step out of our comfort zone and step into the all-trusting, all-knowing acceptance and belief in Jesus Christ, and we live that victory out everywhere we go. And Lord God, for those who don't know you yet, give us opportunities. Give us divine appointments to introduce them to you. And through you, your church will grow. Through you, your body of believers will grow. Through you, the kingdom will grow. So God, I just pray for those that don't know you yet. I pray they will come to that victory and that acceptance. I pray over this house. I pray over the churches that are preaching the gospel. And I pray over all of Jesus.